Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Summer of Carnage right here on the Venom Vlog. And today we're going to take a look at Absolute Carnage number 3. This will be a mild spoiler review. I probably won't give away the full thing or stuff that happens at the end, or if I do, I'll put up a big spoiler warning. My goal here, you know, with these, some people have asked recently, like, hey, why are you doing more reviews and you're not doing discussion videos? I just didn't want to do full discussions because, you know, when we do our discussion videos, we pretty much talk about every little detail as much as I can in like a, you know, 10 to 20 minute time if I can. But we talk about a lot of details, and I just don't want to give away these books for free. I mean, the older books, I don't see a problem with it because they're older stories. Even when they reprint them, and even though some of you guys haven't read them yet, I still like doing those because the whole point of this show is to fully examine Venom, right? And to get into what makes a character tick and give my point of view, but then also you guys give me an opposing point of view or whatever. And we have a discussion down below. So obviously, spoilers will be discussed in the comment section below. So if you don't want any spoilers, you know, avoid the comment section. But if you want to try this book out for yourself and you were waiting for the digital code, boom, there you go. 1 minute in, there's the digital code. First person to put that code in gets the comic book, so enjoy it. But we will be talking about mild spoilers here. And I did want to just explain a little bit of why, you know, I'm doing reviews of these and not doing full discussions. Maybe when the second movie comes out and I'm kind of looking for more Carnage content to make, because unless there's a Carnage ongoing series at that point, I'm not going to have a lot of Carnage stuff to do, because by the time we finish this season and some of next season, we're going to be through all the Carnage stuff. So I'll be like, wait, we need to discuss more Carnage. Maybe then we'll go back to the trade paperback versions of these and we'll do real discussion videos like we do with our other stuff. But for now, I don't mind discussing the old stuff, but the current stuff, you know, we already kind of did some of that with Venomize and Edge of Venomverse. I was kind of, and Mike Costa's run, I talked heavily about spoilers within the same week or two that the books were coming out. And when I went back and looked at that, I just felt like, I don't want to be like Comic Storian and some of these other people who give away the comic for free the day it comes out or the week it comes out. I hope you guys go read them, and I want you to go read them. And if that means that I hold stuff back so that way you're just like, wait, what happens, and it gets you to go get it, that's what I want. You know, I want you guys to go try these books out for yourself, because my opinion is just my opinion, and I'm just an idiot with a camera in the show. But you guys, you know, you guys watch the show, and a lot of you have different opinions than me, and I like to hear them. So let me know down in the comments below what your opinions are of this series so far and of this issue as well. So here we go. Non-spoilers or minimal spoilers, I'll say. But this book, you know, issue 3, it's kind of showing me some of the stuff Donny Cates does that I don't really like. There's some things about Donny Cates' style and his writing, and I don't know, I kind of rail against it. And then also, you know, as an editor, a former editor myself, I kind of wonder, you know, if the editor stepped in, or if he felt like he had to, or if he was just like, hey, Donny's like knocking out of the park, I'm just going to let him do his thing. I feel like some editors do that, but I notice people get better when they're challenged. And what I noticed from this series is that everyone seems to get along really well, which is fine, and that's good. That makes for a good book as well. But obviously Ryan and Donnie speak each other's language, and they as I heard on their podcast, they seem to be really well together, and because of that, they make great stuff. So this isn't a dig at them on a personal level, but sometimes you do need someone to challenge you, to question, hey, why are we doing this? Or hey, can we, you know, move this here, or transfer this there? And maybe that's happening, but it doesn't come across that way sometimes. And case in point is this opening page here. This page is amazing. It really, really is. The art, visual storytelling is fantastic. It has Miles Morales at the end of the last issue. He got covered in a Carnage suit, and now he's being pulled into the army that Carnage is creating. And this imagery here is perfect for it. It shows his subconscious being dragged down into the darkness, and he's going down in a spiral, and all these red hands are coming up and pulling him down further and further. And it's amazing. It's so good, in fact, that I wish someone would have had the better idea of cutting all the caption dialogue at the front. Literally all of this can be taken away for two reasons. One, because you don't need it. The visual storytelling here is amazing. You have Eddie Brock, though, on a second level saying, I lost the kid. And he's like, Carnage turned him, took him away. You're like, okay, maybe he's telling this to Spider-Man. Maybe that's why, because he's filling Spider-Man in. He got away with Matt Gargan, and he's filling in Spider-Man of what happened. No, that's not what happened at all. It's Eddie Brock talking to the suit, who is fully aware that Miles was transformed, saw it with its own eyes, as Eddie did, and it feels like just wasted space. Honestly, it's like, dude, unless you're getting paid by the word, cut some of this dialogue. I remember there was a comic book I worked on called Monomyth, where I was the writer of it, and the artist, Eric Nanatowski, did this two-page spread, and originally I was going to put this big monologue from the villain on this spread, and you know, explaining, you know, his, not really his plan, but just like him imposing his power and him saying threatening things. And when I saw the artwork that was drawn by Eric and then also colored by PJ Katakutin, I was blown away. I was so blown away, in fact, that I cut the dialogue completely off the page, because one, I didn't want to cover an ounce of their art with any words, because the image spoke for itself. It had this opposing Archangel Michael on top of a three-headed Cerberus dragon creature, dog, you know, from hell, and he's standing up there and he's imposing, he's got a sword, and it says it all. You know you're in deep crap. It's shot upward, like a downward angle looking upward, you know, and it's just menacing and terrifying. And when I saw that, I was like, I'm cutting the dialogue. I wish that was done here, because you literally don't need any of it, especially when you find out that Eddie is just talking to the symbiote. So again, structurally, story-wise, like these things that, you know, Donnie is great with ideas, but sometimes these little moments, I wish he would just step back and go, how can this moment just be better? And in this case, I would say, and again, it's a personal opinion, you can disagree with me all you want, but to me, I would say, to make that moment better, cut the captions out. Get rid of them completely. You don't need them, especially when you find out Eddie is just talking to the suit. The suit knows what's happening. It's right there with Eddie. So the dialogue doesn't make any sense for them to have this exchange. Then there's this great moment with Norman Osborn, and I'm not going to go play by play here, but if you've been watching the animated stuff, you see that Norman Osborn, the part of him that's Norman Osborn inside the, you know, the part that thinks it's Cletus Cassidy, it's starting to come back. It's starting to rise up. And I really like that, especially in the third animated episode that we talked about in the last one. That was really great. And I can't wait to see. I hope Norman turns and throws a complete wrench in everyone's, plans. That would be so awesome and great. But you have this moment here where Norman is standing over Eddie and he's going to like drop something on him, heavy on him. And he's telling, you know, he's trying to talk to Norman. He's like, look, we have Normie. We're trying to cure him from the Codex. You know, we're trying to take it out of him so he won't be harmed. You know, please, there's got to be a part of you in there that cares about Normie, that doesn't want him to turn into a monster. And it gets through. Eddie actually gets through to Norman Osborn. And I loved it. I love that moment. And then the suit, for whatever reason, because now the suit is just, you know, zero tolerance. I'm going to kill everything. I'm tired of this game. I'm tired of being responsible for deaths from my, you know, my offspring. I'm taking responsibility. I'm going to kill Cletus Norman Carnage right now. And it does a move that tries to kill him and kill him permanently. And I was like, okay, why is this like this? It feels like it came out of nowhere. Like I can understand maybe the suit's frustration of what's happening and, oh, we got, you know, we're in over our heads and the Carnage is too powerful and blah, blah, blah. But, yeah, this moment, I was just kind of, it just felt a little too out of left field. I'm like, why wasn't it like that when Eddie's emotions were high trying to save, you know, Miles Morales? Why is it here when Eddie's trying to save Mac Gargan? Maybe because Mac was a host at one point. Maybe the suit's like, yeah, I'm trying to protect two codices here. Miles never really had a codice, I guess. Or I guess the one from the other universe maybe didn't count when he was wrapped temporarily, briefly by the symbiote or whatever. But whatever. I don't know. Maybe that didn't happen. I can't remember. I think that was just a cover image. Maybe not in the book. So there is some back and forth and some tension between the suit and Eddie. It did lead to one moment that I really loved, which is this right here, where Eddie tries to run away with the suit and the suit doesn't move. That visual right there is so fantastic. It's just, it's great. In fact, I would have cut the dialogue there too, probably, and then had another panel added in here. Maybe scoot that over a little bit where Eddie looks back and goes, you know, what? Like, why didn't the suit come with me? That page, that panel right there is fantastic. Like, I love that moment. And I was like, whoa, the suit just stood. Like, Eddie was able to run away without the suit. The suit stayed behind and it wanted to kill Norman Osborn. But Eddie, you know, talks some sense to it. But what I like about that moment is that it's a good setup for later, because Eddie says, hey, we have Normie. So now, you know, Carnage, main Carnage, dark Carnage, or whatever, anything said around the hive, you know, like now that, you know, Miles is doppelganger, although I wish they would have just called him Spider Carnage, unless they're going to bring Ben in at some point, which two issues left, I don't think they're gonna. So anyway, I would have called him Spider Carnage, but I think he's called Zombieote is what Marvel's officially calling him. And Miles, anything said around him or Norman, Cletus, you know, Carnage, whatever, like anything said around them, eventually it can, you know, regular Carnage is going to hear it because they're kind of like a hive mind. So when he says, we have Normie, boom, there you go. That's how, you know, dark Carnage knows essentially where to go later on, because he looks through the memories, I'm guessing, you know, because they don't really say it in the book, but I guess because, you know, the creature, the Grendel, died in Rex's facility, maybe it thought, oh, it could be where Rex is, or, you know, they tailed Eddie Brock and they followed him back to Rex's safe house or whatever. Either way, it doesn't matter. You don't really need that to, you know, understand the story, but the Carnage does show up at the facility at the end, in a really great twist, actually, and I won't say exactly how, but it was a pretty neat moment, and it caught me off guard. I was like, hey, wow, that's cool, that surprised me. But because that happened, it's like, all right, well, that happened because, like, you know, Carnage ended up at Rex's because of what Eddie just said there. So I was like, all right, that's a nice little setup, and it, you know, gives reason to that later. So you know, I go back and forth. Donnie is a great writer, I think, and he. But there are moments where I'm just like, oh, why? Like, and again, just personal opinion. So it's obviously I don't have the right answer. Taking away dialogue isn't the right answer. That's just my choice, my opinion. You know, not theirs, obviously. And everything they did here, this was their opinion and their version. So that's why we have these discussions, right? Why we talk about things in the comments, though, right? But here, you know, I'm just bringing all this up because this leads to my review of the book, which is there's good moments, there's bad moments. There's stuff that I would have personally changed, but I try not to let that affect my review itself of the book. I try not to, you know, it's like, all right, it's my personal taste, so I'll mention what I like and don't like. But as far as reviewing the book and holding it to a standard, I'm trying to just review what they gave us, right? Like, what they gave us here is pretty good. It brings all the heroes together. Unfortunately, there's some release issues here. Venom number 19, which is not out yet, apparently takes place right before this issue and the events that happen in this issue. So that's a little frustrating because it kind of a little spoils Venom number 19. Again, that's comes down to group editing and release and editors and stuff, and the company overall, like getting these books out at a certain time. It's like, I wish 19 was out, or Achilles came out this week as well. I know that's asking a lot of Ibon Coelho to, like, you know, draw all, you know, those three issues all in a really tight time. But I kind of wish it was done on a personal level, because I'm like, I would have really liked to have read what happens, how Sleeper ends up where he does, like what new host he has, which I won't spoil here. But I wish I saw all that happen before we got to this issue. But there is some great moments here, like Eddie with Dylan. There's like a brief moment there that's really good. Peter, I love the moment where Peter kind of is like, look, this is my responsibility. I brought the first symbiote to Earth, you know, in Venom. And I'm going to stay behind. We're going to take the codices out of the Thing and Wolverine and Captain America and all these heroes that went to Doverton with me back during Carnage USA. We're going to cure them. We're going to cure Normie and everyone. And while they're unconscious for a couple hours, you know, you and I will stay on guard. So Spider-Man's like, I'm going to stay behind. And the suit even has a great line. It says, tell him that we've been around since the Dark Ages of Beowulf and everything. Tell him we've actually been on Earth. It's not his responsibility. He can let that burden go. So it's nice to see the suit care a little bit about Peter's feelings. But Eddie goes, yeah, you know what, Pete, you're right. And he goes, I understand where you're coming from. And if you want to stay behind with me, great. He goes, and the suit's like, why'd you do that? And he's like, I need the backup, dude. He's like, it's just me and you, but I need the backup. And the suit is still angry at Eddie. And he's like, look, if you wouldn't let me kill Norman Osborn, you know, once and for all. So if you, you know, hesitate again, I'm going to find a host that will give in and let me do what I want to do. And so Eddie's like, okay, you know, I hear you loud and clear, but you know, let's focus on one thing at a time. So I kind of like that setup because that does have a payoff in the end, even though the end wasn't really awesome in my opinion. But the big thing here that happens is and this I'll spoil because it's a minor thing, but you know, it's whatever, I'm not gonna spoil the last splash page, but before that, you have a moment with Cletus Cassidy being talked to, and you find out, or he finds out, that Spider-Man is Peter. He doesn't know it's Peter Parker, he doesn't know his full identity, but because Eddie says, hey, Pete, get away from him. You know, he goes, you know, just because of habit or whatever, you know, he's like, Pete, get away from him, to warn Spider-Man of danger. That's when, you know, Carnage finds out that Spider-Man's real name is Peter. And I don't think he knew Spider-Man's identity before, which is weird because I would think the way the genetic memories move, he would have, like how it went from Venom, like it went from Peter Parker to Eddie Brock, and Eddie Brock instantly knew who Peter Parker was and knew he was Spider-Man. But then when he had an offspring in Carnage, somehow those memories didn't transfer. But yet they have the memories of ancient Kryptonian symbiotes, Clintars. They have ancient memories of them. Like go back generations all the way to like Carnage remembered that that Silver Surfer once destroyed a planet full of Clintars, but he doesn't know Peter Parker, Spider-Man. So I don't know, but I guess that's gone now. He'll figure it out now. But there's a big moment there where Carnage is given his big spiel, and there's a big moment at the end, which I mean I'm like, oh, okay, whatever. But it didn't seem like a good like ending, like, you know, last page. I mean, it seemed very fanboyish, and not really like I'm excited for this in the story, really. Like when I saw the last page, I was like, oh, that's cool, but I don't know if I'm excited to read the next issue because of that. I think I'm more invested in what's going on with Eddie and Peter and Cletus, obviously, and Carnage. But this, I was just kind of like, hopefully this lasts like 10 minutes in the next issue and then that's it. Because it really, I'm just like, whatever. I don't know. It feels like something that would have been in like a fun book, like Venomized or Edge of Venomverse, but not in this one. So yeah, you know, either way, those are my thoughts on this book. My last thought I'll give away though, is that this is 20 pages of story and art for $5.99. And I gotta say, I just don't feel like it was worth, it was $4.99. For 20 pages of art, it was $4.99. And I would say I don't know if it's worth that. It's a good book, granted. And if you're collecting the series, obviously you're going to buy it to keep it going, which is why I have it, so I can do these reviews and stuff. But for 20 pages, and granted, it's great artwork and it's a pretty good story, I don't know, for $5, because the way I look at things when you structure a book and, you know, putting it all together, is that if you're going to put a $4.99 price tag on it, I think Marvel does it just because it's an event book. And I think DC does this too. So it's like, all right, on that regard, I guess I'll give it a pass because that's a standard that they set where all event books are, you know, closer to $4.99 and not the $3.99. But when you're paying $4.99, I look at what you give, you know, what I get in my hands. And in the back, I'm like, all right, so let's say $3.99 is the price of the 20 pages. So the stuff past that, the supplemental stuff, it should be worth $1. Right? Or the 20 pages should be worth $4.99 and the supplemental should be, you know, the nice free stuff that you get on there. But this book, I didn't feel like it had that balance because in the back, what they give you is 2 pages of letters, which is great for fans, you know, who get their letters in. But then there's Absolute Carnage, the sketch covers. Mark Bagley did 20 different covers and put them in different, you know, copies of number one of Absolute Carnage. Apparently some are still out there, but I think this is outdated. So that's the downside of, you know, putting this in a printed book is I think by now they've found over half of them, I think, because I saw like someone on Instagram, you know, referencing the people that got theirs. And I think there was more than just like 5. Right here, it just shows 5. But whatever, I don't know. So that's in there. Then there's ads, obviously. There's like Scotty Young stuff that's coming up. But then you get the Ravencroft backup, which is fun. I think they're talking to Shriek. Frances Louise Barrison, I'm blanking if that's her real name or not. It says her first appearance was in Spider-Man Unlimited, Volume 1, Issue 1, which I think was part one of Maximum Carnage. And I think that was when Shriek first appeared, or maybe she appeared before that. So you'll have to correct me. Who's Frances Louise Barrison? Off the top of my head, I can't remember. But they talk about the character in the book. Is Frances Carrion, maybe? They say Miss Barrison, so I'm blanking. Yeah, I'm honestly blanking. I was reading this and I was like, who's Miss Barrison? I should have looked it up. I'm so sorry. Anyway, it's a neat thing. This person is talking about, Francis is saying how their jacket is like, you know, they want it badly. And they were like, oh, we don't remember you being checked in with a jacket. And I'm like, yeah, but it's important. You know how some people wear badges of honor and they sew patches on their jackets? Well, I did that to mine with all the people I killed, and basically implying that their jacket is essentially made of flesh in a way, which is creepy and gross, but it also comes across as like a young writer trying to be dark and edgy and creepy. But whatever, it works. It's fine. But I'm bummed. I'm bummed. I'm kind of blanking on who Francis is. And I don't want to like cut just to go look that up and look like I'm Mr. Know-it-all. I genuinely don't remember. So let me know down in the comments and you know, help update my you know, brain a little bit and help me figure out who that character is. Because I thought it was Shriek, but I think Shriek did appear before Maximum Carnage? No, that was the Clone Saga. So maybe it is Shriek. I don't know. Whatever. But then in the last pages, there's an art gallery of different variant covers, which is cool. I like, giving a shout out to all these artists. And I know some people live in small towns and or they live in places where they don't get access to the variant covers. And so this is a nice way to, keep track of them all. Maybe someone will see something in here and go, oh, I like that. I'm going to look it up online, see if I can buy it somewhere. So I like things like this. But again, they should be free bonus stuff, not really like, even this. I'm like, I don't know if I would have put the $4.99 tag on it because I don't feel like that's worth an extra dollar. And I don't feel like the first 20 pages are worth $4.99 on their own to make that backup stuff worth, even being free because I don't see the value in the first 20 pages. Although I did like the story overall, but it's just like, it's 20 pages. I felt like it could have benefited from a couple more pages. Just maybe like two or three. But I understand drawing, getting stuff on time. Ryan Stegman's got a crazy schedule. So obviously I'm fully aware of what it takes to make a comic book, but I still, like, I just had I don't know. I had to mention it. This is a thought I had in my head, and who knows? Maybe I'll change my mind later. But when I read this, I was like, "Oh, it was a fast read. It went really quickly." And even though I studied the pages and I was looking at the artwork and trying to look for little Easter egg things and stuff, I still went through it really quickly. And so for that reason, I was like, "Ah, I don't know about the $4.99 price tag, but I think that's where we're going with comics." And like I said, it's an event book, and I think that's kind of the standard that both Marvel and DC do is 20-page event books for $4.99. So if that's the case, then who am I to argue? But I had to cancel other books that I was reading, like Dead Man Logan, and luckily Green Lantern has one issue left, and luckily Doomsday Clock takes forever to come out. But other stuff that I've been reading, like other Marvel titles and other DC titles, I've cut them all. I had to take them all off my pull list. The Jonathan Hickman X-Men stuff, I wasn't really digging it anyway, so I was kind of like, I'm not paying $5 every week for one of these books. I'm not really digging it. But those aside, I still canceled like I think 10 books just to keep up with Absolute Carnage financially because I'm not Mr. Moneybags, and so it was tough. I was like, all right, man, like between medical stuff I got to pay and credit card stuff and real life stuff and keeping a roof over my head and my dog and everything going on, so it's like, yeah, I have real life, real world responsibilities, and I love comic books. More and more, like I'm collecting less and less, and it's such a bummer. So when they get to $4.99, it's hard. There might even be a week where I can get the main book and not one of the tie-ins, just because that's how many are coming out now. But we're winding down, we're getting near the end. So hopefully, I'm gonna sell some stuff that I have here at home to make a few extra bucks, and hopefully that'll help carry me to the finish line with Absolute Carnage. But these are all things I think of. When I'm reviewing something, it's not just the content of the book, but it's the quality of the book, it's the price of the book, it's everything. And I'm always going to give my honest opinion about that stuff, whether you agree or not. So if you do agree, let me know down below. And if you don't agree, definitely let me know down below. And we'll continue our conversation down there with spoilers and everything. You can let me know what you thought of the last page. And like I said, if you haven't read the book yet, don't look at the comment section because chances are someone will throw up, like what happened on the last page. And it is a cool moment, but it wasn't like, it didn't wow me. It wasn't like, what happens next? It wasn't one of those kind of moments for me. But maybe it was for you. So if it was, let me know down in the comments below and we'll continue our conversation down there. Thanks so much for watching the show. As always, I know this is a long video, but I had a lot to say about this issue. So I appreciate you guys sticking it out with me. And I have one more review coming up for Lethal Protectors number 2. I'll be doing that video next, but it'll probably take me a day or two to get to it because I just got a lot on my plate right now and I got a big work week and it's, Batman Day tomorrow and I got to go to bed soon because I have a big day for that. I'm going to be there for like 10 hours, like working the event for Lego and stuff. So I got a lot on my plate right now. So I'll get back to you guys as soon as I can. But hopefully you guys like this video and that's why I spent more time with it because I knew this might be the only video I'd be able to put up this weekend. And let me know what you think of the new background, if you like it and stuff. Let me know. I'd love to hear your thoughts. The purple light, purple and blue lights kind of calm me, so I was like, I'll do purple and we'll see how it works out. So you guys let me know. And I have a little bit of everything I love back there now. I have Transformers, Halo, Marvel, DC, Venom. I got a little bit of everything, and obviously the walls all decorated in Venom too. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that as well. To see what do you think of my new set? I feel like a real YouTuber now. But anyway, thank you so much for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and I'll see you all in the future. Peace.